Welcome to the Wreck family. If you're here every week, welcome back, y'all. I'm seeing some people I hadn't seen in a while, so this is, I think we're starting to see some people come back that hadn't come back, and it's exciting to see some of you guys. And listen, we got a couple of summer camp. Come on up. Come talk about camp. So summer camp signups are live right now. You can go to EmeraldCoastFellowship.com/TheWreck, okay? And you can sign up there, or you can bring a check, and you can drop it off at the welcome desk. Can we hit that kill the hazer for a second? And it's $225. I talked to Student Life yesterday. We are full speed ahead for summer camp, okay? That area, Alabama, is a lot like this area of Florida, and there's going to be a lot of mask mandates at camp, but we are full speed ahead right now for summer camp, okay? So we're going. You guys know Shaco Springs. Check us out on Instagram for all the latest updates, and we're beginning to post some videos of past camps, okay? And so that way some of y'all don't know what camp is, that way you can get an idea. We're not in a room all day praying, okay? There's a lot of prayer, a lot of scripture, but man, there's a lot of fun. And at the end of the week, we get to raise the recreation trophy because we destroy everybody.
Every year.
We kill people. So anyway, you guys, athletically, come on. All right, so you guys, real quick, talk to me about camp. Tell me who you are, and you don't go to high school anymore. She's a volunteer, and I'm trying to get her on the camp trip. So anyway.
I'm Abigail, I'm in college. I'm at Gold Coast right now. But I've been to camp 3 times, I think. And one of my favorite parts about camp is worship. So we love doing worship here. But imagine that, like, 10 times bigger, because there's a huge stage.
Like 1,500 people.
Yeah, there's a ton of people. And it's like everyone's there for one reason. Everyone's there to worship God, and everyone's there to get closer to God. So there's no, like, holding back. You just worship God freely the whole week, and it's amazing. That's my favorite part of camp.
All right, so what's up?
All right, my name's Sam. I'm a senior at North Bahamian.
Some of you,
Eagles to North Bahamian. I'd say my favorite part of camp has always been small groups. You know, getting the chance to really dive deep into God's Word and do it with people your age, and a lot of the times people that you're friends with. I mean, you can do it anywhere, but getting to do it at camp, it's a lot of fun. You know, there's a different level to it.
What is happening?
I think she got a
proper pick
stuck in the door.
Does anybody have a guitar pick?
I'm trying to talk about it. Yeah.
Do you really? Everybody give Daniel Wade a hand. Sorry. Okay, I wasn't expecting that to happen during the announcement. So, all right. So, everybody give Sam your attention. Sorry, Sam.
It's okay.
All right, go.
All right, just to kind of recap, small groups, it's always been my favorite. I love, like I said, getting to dive into God's Word with my friends, with people my age, and you know, just getting the chance to, you know, find a deeper meaning behind things and learn a lot about God's character. That's always been my favorite part.
Cool. So. Yeah, awesome. So go to @ECF_rec on Instagram, and we're going to start posting a lot of pictures and a lot of videos so you can get an idea of what a day is like in camp. And listen, it's $225, but listen, if money's an issue, that should never keep you from going to camp. Swallow your pride. Come talk to me. We can make it happen, okay? So let's pray, and then we will stand and head into worship. God, we love you, and we thank you. And we're talking about a sensitive subject tonight that a lot of people have a lot of different opinions on. Some of them are painful. And God, tonight my prayer is that what is said from this stage would be heard, and people wouldn't hear what they want to hear. I pray that your word would speak loud, as we're using a lot of scripture tonight. And I pray that we would understand, have an accurate understanding of your word when we leave here tonight. But we thank you for your son, Jesus. We thank you for this time to stand in here and praise you as one unified body of believers in Jesus who want to live lives that bring honor and glory to you. In your name we pray. Amen. You guys stand. Let's worship.
Who am I?
Thank you. Thank you. would just love to say we thank you for all you've done for us. We thank you that you're holy. We thank you because you're God. We thank you because you're in control. We thank you because you died for us so that we could be free. We thank you that you left the 99 to find the one. And that one is us. Lots of the times, it has been us. We thank you for that. Thank you that you're a God that loves, a God that is with us, a God that never fails. Father, I just pray for Doug as he speaks. I pray that you speak through him. I pray we can listen, we can receive it. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Alright, so I'm going to have to fly through this tonight, but that was good. Thank you, band. Thank y'all. You guys put in an awful lot of work every week, and to make this go every single week, and it's amazing what is able to happen because of your all's efforts. But all right, so I told the middle schoolers that we were going to handle this like adults, and I need you to hear what I'm saying, not what you want to hear me say. Does that make sense? I'm not going to say anything crazy. I'm going to read God's Word, and we're going to talk about God's Word tonight. But before we get into that, we talked about with the middle school hour that sex is everywhere, and everybody's talking about it, and everybody's thinking about it. It's everywhere. You turn on Twitter, Snapchat, it's there. You get on the news, it's there. You watch TV, whether it's a pay channel like HBO or Showtime, or whether it's just a network cable, it's all over the place. Sex is everywhere. You go to checkout at Walmart, and you get to the checkout counter and turn around, and there's all these magazines that give women 100 different ways to blow your guy's mind. Right? Everywhere guys go. Gentlemen, we walk down we don't have them all here, but if we had them all here, you'd walk down, and every image on the walls is selling a product, not because of whether the product is any good or not, but it's selling a woman's body with the product. The Super Bowl is on this weekend. Every commercial is going to sell a product through a woman's body. Right? I mean, think about it. Sex is everywhere. Your friends are talking about it. You're thinking about it. You may be having it. You may be doing things leading up to it. But it's everywhere. People make jokes about it. People wonder about it. And when we talk about sex, everybody has a different idea about it. Some think it's a sacred act for marriage. Some think it's just a physical transaction between two people with no emotions or feelings attached, and you're just blowing steam and having a good time. Others wonder if it's as great as everybody on TV wants you to think it is. Can it be that life-changing, as some people say it is? Is sex just for having kids? There's entire religious orders that think the only thing that sex is for is having kids. Is it dirty? Some people may have grown up in a household where you were never even given the birds and the bees talk because people thought it was nasty and dirty, and your parents just hoped you would never ask the question. You know, some think about sex and the first thing and the only thing that comes to their mind is the pain that has been inflicted upon them by sex. Whether it be that they are a victim of some sexual sin, of abuse or rape or something like that, or maybe sex has destroyed your parents' marriage. Maybe one parent had an affair, stepped out on the other parent, and it blew your family up. Maybe you were born before your parents got married and they never got married, and maybe some of you don't know who either your mother or your father is, or you know who they are and they're not involved and you just want them involved in your life. So sex, when that word carries a lot of different meanings to a lot of different people. And tonight what we're going to do is we're going to dig into God's Word, because in a sexualized culture, the number one place that we should be going is God's perfect Word that was just as good thousands of years ago as it is today, will be just as good thousands of years ago from now as it is today, because the author of the world created, or the creator of the world authored it. And the second thing that we're going to do is I want you to think of sex, and some of you guys have heard this illustration, of like a fire, okay? When fire is in the boundaries that God created for it to exist in, Fire is an incredible thing. Like if you're camping outside and it's cold, you put rocks in a circle, you put the fire in it, it keeps you warm, it allows you to purify water, it allows you, it keeps the animals away, it gives you light, it provides a lot of great stuff. Same thing as a fireplace in your house. If you go to the mountains, a chalet in Gatlinburg or somewhere, there's going to be a fireplace there, you put logs in it, you light them, and it warms the whole house up. But what happens if fire gets out of that fireplace and touches the carpet or the sheetrock? It burns everything it touches. It destroys everything it touches. If fire, when you're camping, gets out of the area that it's supposed to be in and it touches trees and grass and underbrush, it spreads and it destroys everything it touches. A couple of months after our hurricane, literally an entire town in California burnt to the ground because a little fire got out of the boundaries and destroyed everything in that town. Literally everything. Sex is a lot like fire. In the boundaries of marriage, sex, I'm just going to say it, sex is awesome. Okay, can I get the awkwardness out of the room? Okay? It can be great when used properly. But when you get out of the bounds, see, now you're laughing. I got you. I had to break it. It was getting a little tense in here. So the best way a preacher can break the ice is to make fun of himself. But anyway, here's the deal. It can be a great thing in the right boundaries. But listen to me. Most of what you see in your world is not sex in God's idea, not sex in God's boundaries. And that's why so many lives get destroyed by sex. Just this week in Bay County, just this week, and Captain Daffin's in that parking lot, you can ask him because he's the one that did this. This week, a guy was arrested in Bay County for trying to convince an underage girl to have sex with him. In the same week, a jury sentenced the man for child pornography. It's everywhere. Everywhere we go, people are taking sex out of God's design for it, and it's hurting people everywhere. All the child advocacy people, a lot of those people that run that place go to church here. I know these people. Sex destroys everything it touches outside of God's bounds, boundaries for sex. So let's look at this. What is God's plan for sex? Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2 give us two descriptions of the same event. That is the creation of the world. Genesis chapter 1 gives you more of a 30,000-foot view of day 1 through day 7. And Genesis chapter 2 gives us more of the creation of Adam and Eve and the establishment of the family. Okay? So here we go. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. Then God said, and it'll be on the screen, then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness. That is huge. And you need to understand that. That you, as a human being, I don't care your gender, your skin color, your country, where you are from. Every human being is made in the image of God in His likeness. We are made for God, to know God, and to accomplish God's purpose for our life here on earth. You want to know your purpose in life? You want to know what God's plans are for your life? It is to know Him and bring Him honor. That's it. Everything else is the cherry on top. Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over the livestock and all the wild animals and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in His own image. In the image of God, He created them. What? Male and female. Male and female. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. So you know what that means? He created a man, He created a woman, He married them, and He said, go make babies. That's what He told them to do. Be fruitful. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule the earth, rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Over in Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, the Lord God said, it is not good for man to be alone. So at this point, Adam had no companion. He had nothing except animals. I will make a helper suitable for him. Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky, and He brought them to the man to see what he would name them, and whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds, and all the wild animals. So here's Adam. He's named everything. He's ruling over creation, but Adam's missing something. He's missing something. He has no companion. He has no one to do life with. He has no one to share his life with. So for Adam, there is no suitable helper was found. So the Lord put him into a deep sleep, and while he was sleeping, he took one of Adam's ribs and enclosed up the place of flesh. Then the Lord God made woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to Adam. Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man." Can I put that in English for you? Adam saw Eve and went, "That's what I'm talking about. God, I appreciate the dogs. They're great. They follow me around. I thank you for the cattle. I thank you for the birds and everything else. But I really thank you for that one. She's different from the rest of them. There's something special about her, and she smells a lot better than that dog." Now, Eve was probably sitting there going, "Thank you for him, but I don't really know if he smells better than that dog. And he definitely probably doesn't look as good as that dog." But here you go. You got Adam and you got Eve in the garden, and they're made to be each other's companions. They're made to offset each other with strengths and weaknesses. And then he says this. God says this. "That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Adam and his wife were both naked," or as we say growing up, naked, "and they felt no shame." Did y'all not say that? Am I just a redneck from Tennessee? Yeah, so okay. So Adam and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. Okay, so let's talk about this. Why did they feel no shame? Because it was right. It was in God's boundaries. God created them to be a partner, to be a companionship, to become one flesh. Adam and Eve, two separate people that became one flesh. How do they do that? Through developing intimacy and sex, and committing themselves to each other until death do we part. So God created sex and takes sex seriously. Biblically, sex can only happen in a marriage covenant of a man and a woman. Not two dating people, not two people engaged, not two people living together that aren't married. It's between a man and a woman who have stood before God and people and said, "I will be with this person till the day that I die. I'm committing my life to this person." It's like what me and Carrie did when we got married in 2008, right before the LSU-Alabama football game in Baton Rouge. I'm that guy. I got married before that game. And I stood on that altar, and between bawling my eyes out because I finally found a woman that would even go on a date with me, much less marry me. I would, yeah, see, I convinced one. That's all it takes is one, guys. If everybody else says no, you just got to have one say yes, you know, to get married. So here's the deal. Here's the deal. Listen to me. On that altar, I looked at her in the eye and put a ring on her finger and said, "I will be with you till the day that one of us dies. I will honor you. I will cherish you. I will respect you. I will try to be the husband that you deserve." And I promised her, and we committed before God and everybody else, that we were going to be married. And then once you become married, God says that when you have sex, biblically, you become one with that person. It's called a mingling of the souls. It's kind of the idea behind the Hebrew in this, the original language. It's just like the intimacy part. It's sex is not just a physical act. It is a spiritual act. It is an emotional act, and it is a physical act. There's so much more involved than just having a moment and then going your separate ways. Biblically, what you're doing when you have sex with someone is that you are telling them that you are giving yourself to them forever, for the rest of your life. So when you have sex with someone outside the bound of marriage, you are taking something God created that is excellent and good And you're promising someone something that you have no intent of following through with. Well, I'm going to get married to him one day. You're not married. There's no caveat in here. There's no loophole. It's black and white. Don't have sex unless you're married before God between a man and a woman. Because if you do anything else, it destroys lives. So you become one with that person in flesh, emotionally, spiritually. It's like when you put, this is a dumb illustration, but it's like when you put two pieces of duct tape together and try and pull them apart, you can't, it just destroys everything. Because when you come together as man and wife and you enter into a sexual union, you're becoming one. You're mingling your souls because there's something about sex that intertwines people. It's not just a physical act. I don't care what you see in the movies. I don't care what you read about online. I don't care what you look at. I don't care. And here's the deal. One thing we're going to talk about in a couple weeks, the high majority of actresses and pornography videos are victims of sexual abuse and rape. So when you view, not maybe in that act, but it's in their past. So when you view pornography, you're taking a creation, an image made in God, and you're devaluing that person to the only worth they have is to bring you a physical pleasure, and then you're done with it. When you choose to have sex with somebody outside of marriage, you're devaluing yourself, them, and your future spouses because you're saying, I'm going to take something from you that is not mine to take, and you're a thief. No better than stealing something off the shelf of Walmart. Because you are taking something that God did not intend for you to have or for you to give to that person outside of the bonds of marriage. So here's the deal. Why does it cause so much destruction? Because of what we just talked about. Sex is not just physical, it's spiritual and emotional. And it bonds people together. And God is direct when he says how to use sex and how not to use sex. Leviticus talks a lot about how not to use sex. Song of Solomon, oh boy. He gets direct. The first half of Song of Solomon, the first couple of chapters, talks about how much he loves his bride-to-be. But guess what? He don't touch her. Then you see the post-wedding and that description. And that goes from, baby, I think you're beautiful, to baby, I'm going to sample the fruit of your garden. You need an imagination to figure out what that's talking about? Did you notice the difference? In one, it's hands off, it's respect. In the other, they're married. Game on. So what happened? So here's the deal. God is extremely upfront about this. And he's very direct on not taking sex out of his plan. Listen to this. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4. Marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure. For God will judge the adulterer and all the sexual immoral. I tell you, guys, you get married and start looking at porn, it's going to affect your wife. If you look at porn now and you desensitize your brain, it's going to affect your future. Things can be healed, but it matters. We're going to talk in a few weeks about how porn changes your brain, just the same thing that cocaine does. We'll talk about the dangers of it. It's not just something to look at. But guys, this says honor people. I mean, more than just marriage, honor people. This is marriage should be honored by all and the marriage bed kept pure, for God will judge the adulterer and all the sexual immoral. Second verse here, 1 Corinthians 6, 18 through 20. Flee from sexual immorality. It doesn't say walk the line. It doesn't say how close you can get to the ledge without falling off, right? It doesn't ask the question, how far is too far? We're going to get into that next week. But it doesn't say that. And what does it say? It says flee. Turn and run. 1 Corinthians 6, 18. Go ahead and put that up there. Next verse. Flee from sexual immorality. All other sin a person commits is outside the body, but whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? All right, let's break that down. We could spend a month just on this. We've talked about when you sin sexually, you're sinning against yourself and the other people, and it does something inside you. How do I know this? We have a counselor on staff here, and I've talked to other counselors across America. You want to know two of the biggest issues that people deal with in their marriage? Money and sex. Money and sex. Sexual sin before they got married, sexual sin in their marriage, and now their marriage is crumbling because of sexual sin. Because of pornography, because of stepping out, because of not honoring your spouse in multiple ways. But sex is a big part of it. Why? Because when sex is not handled right, it destroys everything it touches. It's like the fire that gets out of the fireplace. And I got to hustle. I'm sorry. We're going to run over just a tad tonight. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you? How do you become a temple? What's this talking about? Paul's talking to Christians who have been saved from their sin by the blood of Christ that was shed on the cross for them. See, when Jesus went to that cross and he stretched out his arms and he allowed them to put nails through his wrists, and he stood there on that cross and he died in our place on that cross, he didn't die for his sin. He died for your sin and my sin. He died for the sin of Doug Moore so that Doug Moore could be saved and have an eternal relationship with the God that created me. And when Jesus died on that cross, he took my sin on himself, died in my place, so that he would then have the authority to forgive me when he arose from the grave 3 days later. So when you become a Christian, the Holy Spirit lives inside of you, and you become a temple of the Spirit that God has given us. And then it says, you are not your own, for you were bought at a price. Another passage says that you were not bought with gold or silver, but you were bought by the blood and death and torn flesh of Jesus Christ. And when Jesus Christ saves you and you surrender your life to Jesus, you are no longer your own, but you belong to him for his glory, his fame, and to accomplish his goals for your life, for his glory. And so part of that is honoring him with your body, with the temple that the Holy Spirit lives in. Because everything you do, everywhere you go, the Holy Spirit is there with you. Nothing is hidden from God. Everything you do either brings honor or dishonor to God. It either furthers the kingdom or doesn't further the kingdom. There is no secret sin. Because God knows all. God knows our hearts. And you were not created to put an exterior out that is honoring God, and then internally you are sinning and hurting that relationship with God through secret sins with other people or by yourself in your room on your iPhone. You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body and with your life. So he's clear about how serious sex is. That in the bonds of marriage, this is an incredible gift for two people to experience over the lifetime of their marriage. Outside, it destroys everything. So I'm going to talk to two groups real quick tonight. That is those that have been wounded by sin because someone sinned against you. In a room this size, there's going to be somebody with abuse in their background. There's going to be somebody who was raped. There's going to be somebody that was one of those two or sexually assaulted. Somebody in this room has more than likely had someone sin against you sexually. That was not your fault. It was not your fault. You are not worthless as a person. You are not less of a person because of that. You are a victim of a crime that somebody did to you. But you also have a loving Father in heaven who loves you enough to die for you and didn't want to just save you, but he wants to help you become who he wants you to be. And part of that is healing the pain that some of you may have in your life. It is not something to be ashamed of. It is not something to think your life is ruined, because in Christ there is hope. in Christ, whether your pain is sexually related or it's some other type of pain, God says, come to me, you who are broken and weary. He says this in another verse. He says, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. There is no pain in your life that is bigger than the love and grace and healing of Jesus Christ. You do not have to walk through that alone. The second group I want to talk to are those that have willingly entered into sexual sin. Is that, yeah, it's a sin. It's against God's law. But I want to read you this passage in John chapter 8. And it's where Jesus is brought a woman caught in sin by a group of men, thrown at his feet, and said, stone her, because that's what the Old Testament law says. And this is how the story went. At dawn, Jesus appeared again at the temple courts, where all the people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now, what do you say? They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. Not only were they embarrassing and humiliating this woman, she had been caught in sin. But now they're just embarrassing her and humiliating her. But they also use her as a prop. They didn't care about her. They were using her as a prop. They didn't care about her feelings. They didn't care about her emotions. They didn't care about her as a person. She was just something for somebody to get a sexual release on and to be done with. Then they drag her, humiliate her, throw her out in the street in front of Jesus. And they do it, all in order to trap him. But then Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. And when they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. Again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left, with the woman still standing there. Jesus straightened up and asked her, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? And then this is awesome. She says, no one, sir. Then Jesus says, neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life of sin. I've had a lot of friends in life that got themselves in trouble willingly with their girlfriend or their boyfriend. I've known people make their lives incredibly difficult because of what they did outside of the bounds of marriage. And God would say to them the same thing that he said to this lady. He said, you sinned. You messed up. But repent, pick yourself up off the ground, and carry on with life, because in Jesus Christ there is hope, there is peace, there is restoration, and you have a future. Some of you have been in relationships. Maybe somebody here has been in a relationship to where you had sex or you had other things leading up to it. And after the relationship was over, you were broken and hurting and embarrassed, and you would do anything to go back and redo that and not do any of it. Let me tell you this right now. When God looks at you, he doesn't see sexual sinner. He sees someone that he created, that he loves, that he died on the cross for, that he has a plan for your life to bring him honor and glory. And it starts with you coming before him at the foot of the cross, whether it's a sexual sin or anything else. We all need to do this. Come to him at the foot of the cross and say, Jesus, I am a sinner. I am separated from you, and there is nothing that I can do to ever have or deserve a relationship with you. But because of what you did on the cross for me, I'm asking you to forgive me of my sin and to adopt me into your kingdom as a child of God. And you do that, and he will save you, and he will forgive you, and he will restore you, and he will be able to grow you and mold you into the person that he wants you to be. If you are a Christian and you fall into any kind of sin, You go to God and you say, I'm sorry for what I've done. I'm out of liked it. I might not even see where it's wrong, but your word says it's wrong. So I'm asking you to change my attitude, change my mind, and help me see how you want me to live my life. But here's the thing, and this is a question that any Christian needs to look in the mirror and ask themselves. In Corinthians, it said you were bought at a price. And here's my question. Since you became a Christian, has your life changed? Has your behavior changed? Because in the culture we live in, a Christian should stand out right now. Not just sexually, in general. But in the early church, the first century church, one of the things that made Christians stand out was their sexual ethics. Because they lived in a pagan, godless society. It was, quite frankly, gross. And a lot of the norms of the day. And people thought Christians were weird because of sexual ethics. And is your life different because Christ saved you? If it's not, then you need to do a hard look in the mirror when you get home and say, God, help me become the person you've called me to be. Because your word clearly says that if any area of my life is outside of your boundaries and what you say is right and wrong, it's not going to work. As a Christian, I can't live a life that's opposite of your word. So that's the question. Is your life different because Jesus has saved you? Because it should be. If you've fallen into sexual sin, don't feel judged in this room. I'm not judging you. And listen, one day when you date somebody and you're considering marriage, you have to talk about your past. If somebody can't get over what you've done in your past, you need to reevaluate whether you need to date that person. You listening to me? Like in college, I used to hear people say, I don't know if I can... I really like them, but I don't know if I can date them because they did this with that guy or they did this with that girl. You're just as much a sinner as they are. Are they just supposed to forgive all your past sins, but you can't forgive theirs? So if you've fallen sexually into sin and somebody tries to degrade you or devalue you because of that past mistake, you need to really wonder if this is somebody you want to spend your life with or date. Does that make sense? You follow me? Guys, we need to respect girls who have fallen into sin. Don't use those words. Ladies, carry yourself with dignity. And if you've fallen into sin, you are not a word that someone likes to attach to ladies who get caught up in this stuff. Because you are a child of God who was created by God for Him. Guys, we need to respect every single girl you encounter because every single girl you encounter is somebody's future wife. And you may not care if your wife is sleeping around right now before she meets you, but you need to respect that girl and her future husband. That lady is not something for you to use for your pleasure and then move on to the next one. Ladies, I'll say the same thing. Because girls are just as aggressive now as guys are. And I see it every day in the hallways of schools. Respect yourself, respect God, respect each other, and respect your future spouse. Does that make sense? And if you fall into sin, turn to God. Because you have a God that loves you more than you could ever imagine. I'm going to pray and we'll be dismissed. Thank you all for being great tonight. You did this very, very well tonight. Thank you. Father God, we love you. We thank you. And God, your word says that if we need, that your word tells us that we have to be saved to have a relationship with you. Your word tells us that we're all fallen sinners, that we all need redemption through the blood and death and sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And outside of surrendering our life to you, we have no hope, we have no peace, and we have no future. Because we were created for you, by you. So there's somebody in this room that needs to begin a relationship with you. I pray that they would talk to somebody before they leave here tonight. For your word says, if we believe in our hearts that you are the Lord of the earth, that you died on the cross, that you arose again, that you provide the only pathway to peace with God, we will be saved. If we believe in our heart and confess it with our mouth. But then, after we're saved, you command us to grow in our walk with Jesus. That word sanctification. And that once we're saved, there should be something different about us over time. That when people look at us, they should notice that we have a different character and a different ethic and a different just identity than those who don't know you. So help these teenagers storm Bay County with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Put their one person in their mind that they need to be praying for, sharing their faith with, and inviting to church so that they might have the same salvation that they have. Let us never forget that we were made for something bigger than ourselves. We were made for you. And if there's hurting people in this room, I hope they heard my heart tonight, and I hope they will turn to you, God. We love you and we praise you. In your holy and precious name, amen. Love you guys. See you next week. Thanks for letting me run over. They can't take me
like everywhere.